Amen. Let's stand up and worship Jesus this morning. King of kings and Lord of lords. He is the only name under heaven given among men whereby we can be saved. That name of Jesus, who is precious to us this morning. And I hope that you have been saved. I hope that you've called upon the name of the Lord. And if you've been saved, if you know that you're a child of God, that the Holy Spirit lives within you, then today's a day to worship Him corporately with your family here. And come get recharged, get filled, get what you need today, that you would be equipped for the work that God has called you to. And I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad that our missionary David Bledsoe from Brazil is here with us today, going to share what Christ has been doing in his life and there, and what God's called us to here in this place. I'm just excited about maybe somebody today feeling that call of missions upon their heart. There's a lot going on in the room, but the first thing we want to do is give God the glory that He deserves through praise and worship. Father, we thank You that right now, God, that You're going to be the center of the attention in this room, God, that nothing's going to distract us from You, nothing's going to keep us from seeing You, from knowing You more, God, from understanding You, God, that through the worship and the Word, You're going to reveal Yourself through the power of the Holy Spirit, and we praise You for that, God. God, we've come today just to lift You high. God, we've come today just to give You what You deserve, Lord. And that's because You didn't give us what we deserve. We deserved hell. We deserved the wrath of the Father. But Jesus, You gave Your life a ransom for many, and we thank You for that. God, we look to You right now as we sing. God, we have all these things going on in us and around us, Father. And we know that You are the only one who can take control and change the atmosphere. You can change the landscape of our lives, Lord, that we might do everything that You've called us to. We thank You right now, God, for what You're going to do in this place. May You be glorified more than anything else, God. May You be lifted high. May You have first place, God. May You be the one, Father, who is the center point of all that we do. May this cross behind us be the one before us as we worship You right now in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together, church.
See things like You do, God, I look to You.
aren't you thankful our God reigns today? That He reigns over this nation, that He reigns over this town, that He's in full control of all things. That's why we can praise Him today, because He is God and we are not. And I'm thankful today for what He's done for us. Let's sing this out again. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Sing it out, church. This morning of all the praise that we can give Him. You know, if it was not for the blood of Jesus, for His death, burial, and resurrection, if it wasn't for the God of heaven coming down through His Son and doing this work in our lives, we would be lost and undone forever. See, God is a God who saves, and He's still in that saving business. That's why we're talking missions all month and going into the world and preaching the gospel to every living creature, because God still is saving people. How many of you believe today that God still has the power to save the lost person? Amen. Set the captives free, to bind up the wounded and heal the brokenhearted. God's still in that business. As we sing about a God who saves, maybe you've been saved for years and you just want to worship Him. That's what these altars are always for. It's this opportunity. We'll get the word and be encouraged and edified and built up. But right now is our time to give to God what is His. But maybe you haven't been saved and the Holy Spirit's moving on you right now, and you would give your life. You would confess your sin. You would confess Christ as your Savior. You can also do it during this time, because He doesn't only save during altar time. Amen. He saves during the worship. He saves during the preaching. He saves outside of here in a factory on a Monday morning. I love to know that God still saves, and that's what we're going to sing about right now. Soul once torn and beaten, left without reason to move on. Then You reached down and brought me up from the valley of dry bones. God that saves, You are the one that rescued me. You rescued me. You are the God that saves, and You call me from the grave. You rescue me. Let's sing it out. Ransom, ransom. Out of the wreckage, pulled from the ashes of sin's hole. Thank You, Jesus. Hope is flowing through these veins. Life born from grace, grace alone. You are the God that saves. You are the one that rescues. You are the God that saves, and you call me from the grave. You rescue me. How many of you can remember the time when God rescued you? Amen. I remember that day. It's a long time ago, but I've never gotten over it. And today, heaven's singing over you. Let's sing it together. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song of victory ring over. Sing it out. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory. You are the God that saves. You are the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God. You are the God that saves. You are the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. Call me from the grave. You rescue me. I hear the song. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song. I hear the song of victory ring over me. Song of victory ring over me. You are the God. You are the God that saves. You are the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God, we love you. You are the God that saves. That rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves, and you call me from the grave. You rescue me, and you call me from the grave. You rescue me. Aren't you thankful for a God that saves this morning? Hallelujah. Jesus, we worship you this morning. Amen. Give him some praise, church. He is worthy this morning. A God that saves, our living hope, the only one that we can trust to take us for all eternity. The only one. I don't know what you're living for today, but there's only one living hope, and his name is Jesus. As we sing this song, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. That's why we praise today, not because of some emotional feeling in a church service. Listen to me. I know a lot of lost people who raise their hands during worship because it feels good. We don't do it because of how we feel. We do it because of the knowledge, because of the Holy Spirit living in us, because we know, I know. How many of you know that you're saved? Amen? Amen. How many of you know that Christ lives within you? How many of you know the Holy Spirit is inside? How many of you know that God has settled your account in heaven? And then when Christ came in you, that God looks at you as forgiven and free. That's what we sing about, Jesus Christ. Not our dead hope, not our on the cross hope, not our in the tomb hope, but our living hope, our living hope. Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father and right now is making intercession for you. How great the chasm that laid between us, but not anymore. Christ has covered it. He's made a way. He has bridged the gap. Christ has made a way to you, for you to the Father. And this morning, run to Him in worship. Run to Him in your soul. Give Him all you got today, church. Give Him all of you.
That lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. Desperation, I turned to heaven, spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. Work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living. So great a mercy, what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living. One who set me free, hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me.
Let's sing it again, church.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours. upon me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh Lord, you are my living hope.
Amen. If he's your living hope, give him some praise this morning. Hallelujah, Jesus. You are a living hope. Nothing in you is dead. You are alive and well and seated at the right hand of the Father in power and preeminence, because all of the world is yours and the fullness thereof. Now, God, make all of this room, Father, yours by making them your children, Father, sons and daughters, pressing in to the things of the Father, that we might know you and know what your will is for our lives. We thank you for everyone in this room. So, God, deal with us through your Holy Spirit now and through the Word as we seek your face and not your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Aren't you thankful to be at church this morning? Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. We're going to have a little bit of a change up. But if you want to dismiss your children to children's church through second grade is in the lobby. And also the nursery is already open. And so we'll get started here in just a second. Amen. All right. We thank God for you being here today. I kind of pumped you up the last couple of weeks and letting you know that we had a special treat for us today. I'll just go ahead and tell you, anybody who says yes to Jesus and goes all out for him is a hero to me. And missionaries that not only do it here, but they receive the call from God and they say, I'm going to pack my whole family up, my everything I've got, and I'm going to go to somewhere that I've never been, and I'm going to serve the Lord in those places. For me, when I look at that, I go, wow, amazing how they could just leave all they knew to go to the one that gave them all that they ever had, go serve the Lord. And Mr. Dr. David Bledsoe, brother, whatever you want to call him, missionary, he is your IMB missionary. International Mission Board missionary. You have supported him for 22 years in Brazil through your tithes and offerings and your giving. I want to also explain to you, every week a percentage of our tithes and offerings go to the cooperative program that go to the International Mission Board and the State Board. But also this month, as we raise our money for our missions in May, our mission offering, a part of that, a third of that, we're doing thirds, is going to the International Mission Board also, and it goes straight to the mission field. So I'm thankful for that, and I'm thankful for David. He had to spend an evening with me yesterday, and y'all know how that is. You know what I took him to? A crawfish bowl, all right? And by the time it was over, he was still eating, and I was stuffed, so he put it away last night. And I told him, I said, if this messes you up tomorrow, we can't blame it on nothing, okay? And so I'm as full as I could be still, and I'm glad he's preaching this morning. So let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise, and let's welcome David Bledsoe.
Are we on? Yes. Então, bom dia. Que Deus abençoe a cada de vocês. Okay, I am not Pentecostal, But I just said to you, and I don't mind if someone is Pentecostal, but I just said to you, good morning. May the Lord bless each and every one of you. Amen? So I bring you greetings from Brazil, and I appreciate this opportunity to share with you today the Word of God. And thank you, Brother Matt, for this opportunity. I need to say share two things with you before we begin. First, Matt and I are not blood relatives, okay? And we might look a little alike, but we're not blood relatives. Second of all, we're brothers in Christ. And second of all, I usually speak, anytime I'm behind a pulpit or a lecture, I usually speak in Portuguese. I don't normally speak in English. In fact, Friday night, I was teaching in the city of Rio de Janeiro. It was all by virtual stuff. Yet at the same time, I was doing that. So if something comes out that doesn't sound right, it probably just has to do with me being a little illiterate, okay? I was very literate when I went to Brazil 22 years ago. Now I'm semi-illiterate in two languages. So that's what you get. But I also want to say thank you. Thank you for allowing me to be your Southern Baptist missionary. I tell people that being a missionary is the hardest gig I've ever done, but it's the most blessed thing I have ever done. And so I consider it a privilege. And so we'll talk more about that here in just a moment. Now, I did enjoy last night, oh my, it was phenomenal, to say the least, this crawfish boil. I think I broke every Jewish dietary law known, that's in the scriptures, but it was pretty phenomenal. Thank the Lord, I am in Christ, I have liberty, and I'm a Gentile, so there's no problem with that. So today, here's what we're going to do. I want to speak to you about the last moments and some of the last words of our resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. You know, the last words of somebody usually are held very dearly by those who love that individual before they depart this earth. I like history. And I like to read anything about dead people. In fact, I will probably visit your cemetery on the way out of town today. Why? Well, pretty soon I'm going to be there. So I need to get a little bit comfortable with it. And it reminds me that this world is fleeting. But I usually, when I read history, I read biographies and these kind of things, I notice that these biographies, a chapter will be dedicated to the last moments of that president or whatever that historical figure is. Because it's at that moment, his last words will reveal what he thinks, what he believes, what was precious to him, what was valuable. Well, I remember the last words of my dear father. Now, he was not a president. He was not a historical figure in the sense of someone that somebody will write biographies about. But he was a faithful Christian all of his adult days. A Baptist pastor won him to the Lord as a young adult. He was also a man who provided faithfully to his family, was a model Christian in the community. He actually worked 1 mile from his house, and he actually attended church, participated in his church 2 miles from his house all of his days. And he was buried a half a mile from his house. And to some degree, that's what made America what it is today, what we call the Protestant ethic. But I remember the last conversation I had with my dad. I was in Belo Horizonte. I was in Brazil. And so he called. He was battling cancer, losing it, and his voice was very weak. I made it a point for him to talk to my wife, Laurie, my son, Haddon, and my daughter, Marissa. And it came my turn. And this is what he said, basically. David, I want you to know I love you, and I'm so proud of you. And the Lord is using you greatly. Just keep your pride down. And he said, please pray for me. The next few days are going to be really hard. What I understood was this. My dad faithfully obeyed the gospel all his days. And he was about to enter the valley of the shadow of death. And he wanted those last few days to come out that he would be faithful to his Lord before meeting him. Well, here we're going to look at some of the last few words of Jesus. Now, different from my dad and different from us, Jesus was not confronting death. He already conquered death. But yet at the same time, what he says before he ascended into heaven will be very significant for the church throughout the generations and for us in our generation. So without delay, let's look at some of these last few moments. Turn in your Bible, if you would, please, to the first scene we will look at today. It is in Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Any missionary worth his salt ought to at least go to Matthew 28 if he's preaching. Matthew 28, I'm going to start reading in verse 16. Now let me just kind of give you a mental picture of what's going on here. This is happening in the region of Galilee. That's in the northeast part of what we know today as Israel. In fact, right there, Jesus was going to tell them to go to a certain mountain. And probably at that mountain, they could see the Sea of Galilee. It's really a lake, but we won't go there. It's the Sea of Galilee. And it was right there that this scene was happening. It was somewhere between his resurrection and his ascension, somewhere in between those 40 days that this scene transpired. So with knowing that, let's start reading in verse 16. This is what Matthew recorded. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, that would be Jesus, some doubted. And Jesus came to them. Excuse me, I think I skipped something. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. But some doubted. Verse 18. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to the end of the age." And now let's go to the second scene. Turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. And let me paint a mental picture here of this particular scene. This is on the Mount of Olives, just outside the walls of the city of Jerusalem. You could go there today, you won't see that many olive trees, but what happens is you go out, I believe it's the Lion's Gate, and you descend into the Kidron Valley and you go up, and right there is the Mount of Olives, about a 10-15 minute walk. And so this happens on day 40. This is the day that he will ascend into heaven, where he is right now at the right hand of the Father. And so in verse 6, this is what Luke recorded. Acts 1, verse 6. "So when they had come together," that would be his disciples, "they asked him, 'Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?' He said to them, 'It is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the ends of the earth.' And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes," those would be angels, "and said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven.'" And may the Lord bless the reading of his word and the explanation of his word. Amen. So let's pray together here. If you would, close your eyes with me. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the freedom that we enjoy to come and to open the scriptures. our copies of the scriptures, and so we can reflect upon it. Hear your word, and may we receive it by faith today. May we receive it with an open heart. Lord, I confess before these people my limitations, so many limitations, so many weaknesses. But Lord, I pray that I will be a channel, a blessing to this dear church here today. Lord, that you will use me to edify your church and to admonish whom needs to be admonished. So God, I pray that your spirit will do his work in our lives today. In Jesus' name, amen. So my friends, in light of these two biblical passages we looked at, and as my fellow Christians, my fellow Christian brothers, and also as this church membership, here's what I wanted to do today. I'd like to share just a few initial observations from these two scenes. Second, I want to just share with you also three pertinent lessons that we can glean from these, after these observations. And then I want to give a little missionary report and then a personal challenge. So let's start with a few initial observations. And the first three of these initial observations come from that Matthew passage. So maybe you want to go back to the Matthean passage there. So first observation, I want you to see in verse 17, very simple, the worship of Jesus. The worship of Jesus. You see it right there in Matthew, in verse 17. It says that, and when some saw him, that would be his disciples, they worshiped him. My friend, that separates, those kind of statements separate Christianity from practically all other religions of the world. You see, we do believe in one God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord, he is one. We believe there is only one God. But we see in the scriptures that this one true living God is three persons. We know him, and he has been revealed as Father, Son, eternal Son, and the Holy Spirit. And see, the Jews as well as the Muslims would say, worshiping a man is blasphemous. And it is. It's blasphemy. It's idolatrous. Yet at the same time, we do not worship a man. We worship a God-man, the eternal Son of God who became flesh and dwelt among us and who has been victorious over the grave. And he's at the right hand of the Father. So that's the first observation. Second observation, all authority. Look at verse 18. He says, all authority has been given unto me. You see, Jesus doesn't have just some authority. He has all authority. And so we can sing as a church, he is Lord, he is Lord, he has risen from the grave and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, many people are not allowing Jesus to reign in their hearts, but one day they will confess that he is Lord, and it might be too late at that time. So this is the reason why we do missions. Third observation, I want you to see four verbs in verses 19 and 20. Go, make disciples, baptizing, and teaching. Go, make disciples, baptizing, and teaching. So what's going on there? Jesus is saying, after he declares that he has authority over everything, and they're acknowledging his authority and his divinity, he says, go and make disciples. As you're going, make disciples, other disciples. Make disciples. And how are you going to make disciples? You're going to baptize them, and you're going to teach them to obey everything that I have told you. So that's the third observation. Now, fourth observation. Are you with me still? All right. Fourth observation. Now, you want to turn over to the book of Acts probably there. Well, actually, I'm going to do something in the book of Acts. You see, Jesus said there, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, see, when we look at the scriptures in their entirety, we observe that God's, what we would call great Christ's Great Commission, or God's commission for his redeemed people, was once centripetal. Centripetal. I'll explain that in just a second. What does that mean? Well, that means that his covenant work gravitated towards a specific people in a specific location. Now, that the specific place would be the eventual temple located in Jerusalem for all to see. But you see, after the resurrection of his eternal Son and our Savior, the mission of God's redeemed people is now centrifugal, not centripetal, centrifugal. In other words, it goes out. It doesn't gravitate towards something. Now, let me explain this to you. I live now with Laurie and I. You saw the picture of my bride there. We live in the city of Rio de Janeiro, the small city of Rio de Janeiro, only about 10 million people, and about a little bit bigger than Camden. And so, one of the things I like about living in Brazil are the citrus fruits. Oh my, they're just phenomenal. Pineapple, I know we have some of these things, but they just taste better when they're closer to the ground there. Pineapple, papaya, mango, and bananas. I know you guys have bananas here, but they're from the Dominican Republic. And you'll have one kind of banana. We have 40 different kinds of bananas. And now, yes, I only eat one, but one type. But they're phenomenal. Now, I like to make these things called smoothies. In Portuguese, we call them vitaminas. And one thing I noticed, we live in a small apartment, yet at the same time, I can't find the lid sometimes. So I will improvise, as a guy normally tries to do, doesn't work out very well. And so I will get a plate and put it on top of the blender, or I'll put my hand on top of the blender, and I find out very quickly that the blender doesn't have a centripetal force. It doesn't go in, it wants to come out. And so anything that's in there wants to come out, thus the lid is made for the blender. That's the idea here. God's redeemed people are to go out to make disciples, the new disciples. And we'll go back to that in just a second, but I got to go to the fifth and the last initial observation here. We also see in the book of Acts, especially, the sequential accomplishment of Jesus' great commission throughout the book of Acts. And now this initial accomplishment really only transpired in about 8 years. In other words, he said, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and then the province of Judea, kind of like their county, then Samaria, another county or way, a different kind of people, and then into the uttermost parts of the earth. So what's happening here, that happened about 8 years, if you look at probably the conversion of Cornelius. Now, but this Great Commission endeavor quickly became simultaneous, not sequential, but simultaneous. And now it is especially simultaneous for all of Christ's churches. So what are the implications of all this for you here at Missionary Grove Baptist Church? Well, let me share with you. Let me see if I can pull all these observations together, all these isolated thoughts. Clearly, this church membership is to meet regularly as a covenant community of Christ's disciples who have jointly professed the gospel and who are living out the gospel together. And you do all that under the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Lord Jesus Christ. However, you as a church membership are to always be going and making disciples by your verbal witness and also by your life witness in your area. In addition, you are to be concerned about all people and peoples beyond your immediate area, beyond your immediate county, beyond your state. Why? Why should I be concerned? Why should I be concerned about Syrians? Why should I be concerned about Israelis? Why should I be concerned about Chinese? Why should I be concerned about Koreans? Why should I be concerned about Brazilians or Argentinians? Well, I'll tell you why. Because all have been created in God's image. Every man, every woman has been created in God's image. Thus, every person has intrinsic worth because they have been created in this image of God. That means we are spiritual creatures. We're moral creatures. We are rational creatures. We're creative creatures. These are the qualities of being created in the image of God. But yet at the same time, all are sinners and have fallen short of the glory of God. Thus, all are condemned. And then every individual is in dire need of God's forgiveness and redemption. Now, why should we care about all these different peoples? It's because Christ's invitation for forgiveness and to be his disciple is universal. And in all societies, every culture needs healthy churches. So you see, it's supposed to be centrifugal and it's supposed to be simultaneous. So, now, there you guys, as Brother Matt mentioned to you guys, you guys are here a church membership that belongs to the Southern Baptist Convention. That means you affirm what is called the Baptist Faith and Message. So I'd like for us just to read together out loud an article from this Baptist Faith and Message about evangelism and missions. Let's read this together. And as we read it, let's read it in the spirit of affirmation about what it says in light of God's Word. Let's go. It is a duty and privilege of every follower of Christ and of every church of the Lord Jesus Christ to endeavor to make disciples of all nations. The new birth of man's spirit by God's Holy Spirit means love for others. Missionary effort on the part of all rests thus upon a spiritual necessity of the regenerate life and is expressly and repeatedly commanded in the teachings of Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ has commanded the preaching of the gospel to all nations. It is the duty of every child of God to seek constantly to win the lost to Christ by verbal witness, undergirded by a Christian lifestyle, and by other methods in harmony with the gospel of Christ. Amen? Amen. Now, those are the five initial observations. So let's go now to the three lessons. Three pertinent lessons that we can learn, we can derive from these two biblical texts we read. First lesson. Very simple. To make disciples, remember we're talking about making disciples of all nations. Well, to make disciples, you must first become a disciple of Jesus. To make disciples, you must first become a disciple of Jesus. So, let me ask you a question. It's rhetorical, but let me ask it. How do you know you're a disciple? How do you know the person in front of you is a disciple of Christ Jesus, or next to you? What is the criteria? What is the basis? Just saying you're a disciple of Christ doesn't make you a disciple of Christ. It has to have a basis. There has to be a foundation. What makes an individual a disciple of Christ? Well, let me give you the criteria. You must first hear the gospel, understand the gospel, embrace the gospel, and then, lastly, you must obey the gospel. Let's go through that again. You must first hear the gospel. You know, believe it or not, now I love being here. I noticed in the hotel I was in last night, there were the Ten Commandments right there in the lobby of the hotel. And I know, there's many people who have never heard necessarily what we would call the Ten Commandments or the name of Jesus. So how can a person receive the gospel without actually hearing about Jesus? But once you hear about Jesus, you must understand the message of Jesus. In fact, I don't know if you know this, but Muslims, which are almost the same amount, there's almost the same number of Muslims in the world as they are Christians, of professing Christians. Muslims affirm that Jesus existed, but they affirm a distorted Jesus. So as you see, you need to just not only hear the name Jesus and repeat the name Jesus, but you also got to embrace, understand, and affirm the message of Jesus as is seen in the scriptures. And once you actually understand that, knowledge is key. It's a requirement, but you also have to embrace the gospel of Jesus. Receive the gospel of Jesus. And how do you receive the gospel of Jesus? It's by faith, trusting only in Him, in His righteousness, and not our own righteousness. And also it is acknowledging Him as Lord of our life. We repent of our sins and turn to Christ, to turn to God for forgiveness. So that is what it means to receive the gospel of Jesus. But once we receive the gospel of Jesus, we are obligated to obey the gospel of Jesus. And that's where probably we as Southern Baptists today, we probably have lost some of that discourse. People of old call this the perseverance of the saints. That means that those who have been born of the Spirit, those who have embraced Christ, they are going to persevere until the end. They may fall into temptation, and they may struggle with things, yet at the same time, they are going to stay faithful and hold on to Christ. Now, you see, it's not our good works, it's not our self-righteousness that saves us. In fact, the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 2:10 says, let's look at that. In Ephesians 2:10, he says the following. After he says it's by grace through faith that you have been saved, and this is not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, so that you will not glorify yourselves. He says in verse 10 the following. He says, for we are his workmanship, in God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. That would be a new creation, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. In other words, we are saved for good works. We're not saved by our good works. So we'll come back to that in just a minute. But I just want to ask the following. Have you understood the gospel? If you haven't, then seize the gospel. Don't rest until you find it. Talk to somebody while you're here. Let somebody walk with you. It's okay to say, there's a difference between stupidity and ignorance. Ignorance can be soft. and let somebody walk with you. Thank the Lord somebody shared the gospel with me. And if you have, are you obeying the gospel? Are you obeying the gospel? If you're not, then that needs to be resolved in your life. It sometimes is better for professing Christians to say they're not Christians if they're going to choose their sin rather than Christ. Well, let's go on. Let's look at the second lesson. First lesson, to make disciples, you must first become a disciple of Jesus. Second, to make disciples, well, you must also know what it means to make disciples. To make disciples, you must also know what it means to make disciples. Yeah, how do you make a disciple? Brother Matt mentioned to me yesterday that he was 18 years old, and he said, no one ever discipled me. And that's true of many. But we are to make disciples. So what does it mean to make disciples? Well, let me share with you just a really good definition I read a couple years ago. Mark Dever, he's a Baptist pastor. He comes on the screen right now. And he defines making disciples this way. It is helping others to follow Jesus. That is, making disciples is deliberately doing spiritual good to someone so that he or she will become more like Christ. I like that. It's just basically helping others to follow Jesus, deliberately doing spiritual good to someone so that that person may become more like Christ. I like it because of this. It includes what we would call evangelism, making new disciples. And it also includes helping Christian disciples, helping disciples to grow in their faith and encouraging them in those things. It's wonderful. So how does this work for you guys as this church, as if you're a member of this church? Well, even in the midst of routine duties and obligations that you have, and even in difficult circumstances, which we all pass through, you as disciples of Christ are to be doing spiritually good to others. In other words, it's not just for Brother Matt and the staff of this church, but it's for each of us as Christ followers and members, particularly members of this body, this congregation here. In other words, it's about loving God and loving others, as the Great Commandment tells us. And when you come together, and let me just encourage you on this. I know you guys have a worship service at 8:30 on Sunday, okay? But when you come together, don't come here in this place. This is not a church, okay? You're the church. It's a difference. Or y'all, I'm in the South. Y'all are the church. When you come with the idea of doing spiritually good to your fellow brother and sister. Cry with them. Pray for them. Celebrate with them. Encourage them. You see, the church is one of God's greatest enterprises on this earth. And it's what we would call one of the means of grace so that we can encourage and persevere until the end. So you see, to do spiritually good, we have to take care of one another. But also, we need to be taking care of the souls of others throughout the world. Amen? Now, I know usually I'm talking to some people who come and have benefited from the ministries of this church for probably a number of months or even a number of years. But you are pretty loosely connected. Or you go from one place to another. Well, let me just say a word to you real quick, my friend. It is nearly impossible for any Christian to obey the gospel without participating with other believers in the context of a local church. You see, that's how God intended that Christ's followers would live and function and accomplish their mission on the earth. That is where the intensities of these one another commandments are to show brightly and beneficially. And for that reason, as I mentioned, the church is one of God's greatest means of grace to us. And that's where the ordinances come in. I mean, the ordinances of the church. You saw Jesus saying to his disciples, baptizing them. Baptizing is basically receiving the mark of a Christian disciple after embracing the gospel. And then the Lord's Supper is a moment in which we remember the great cost that was paid for our redemption. And it's our moment for us to renew our hope and also our commitment in the gospel. And renew our hope or our commitment to one another as a covenant community. So, now, those are the three lessons. No, I have one other lesson to share with you. Where is that other lesson? Oh, here it is. I'm sorry. I just got so excited, I just kind of moved on. The third lesson. Churches are a result of making disciples and the divine context to fold other disciples of Jesus into. Churches are. In other words, sometimes in missions, we talk about the Great Commission, but we don't see how the church fits into there. And so in the book of Acts, we observe that as individuals responded to the call to become disciples of Jesus, churches were formed, and then they expanded into other territories. In other words, people heard the gospel, they received the gospel, and they obeyed the gospel. And as a result, churches emerged, and disciples grew in grace and number. And so that is how discipleship connects to the church. And so now I'd like to just give you a little missionary report in light of these two biblical texts. And a little bit about our ministry. And I'm coming here today not to raise money. I'm just coming here to say thank you. As one of your two, as Laurie and I represent two of your 3,800 missionaries to the nations. And so how does this work out in our lives of making disciples, being disciples of Christ and making disciples of Christ? Well, first of all, Laurie and I, in the last 5 years, we were members of two different churches in our particular context. Now, not simultaneously, but we helped a new church, and then after that, that was struggling, and then after that, we went to a little bit more of an established church to be with them, and so that's where we served, and were served, and then also Laurie, my wife, she walked with a number of ladies in their spiritual journey. She also received countless people into our home showing Christian hospitality. Now, why do I mention that? Well, we don't do those things as missionaries. We didn't do those things as missionaries. We did those things because we're Christians. And it's a big difference, but they're significant. Now, but making disciples can be somewhat specialized depending on one's gifting or calling. And that's where my job assignment, if you will, came in as your Southern Baptist missionary. So, a little report about what I did in these last few years. First, I helped a pretty large church as they went through an incredibly difficult time. They asked me to be their interim pastor for a few months before leaving. And so what happened was those members of that church, those disciples in those church, they needed help to understand that their pastor disqualified himself to lead them because of a wrongful sexual relationship that he had. And in other words, he was no longer blameless, as it says in 1 Timothy 3. He was no longer a model disciple. They had to make some hard decisions. So I walked with them through that incredibly difficult time. And then also, my influence was in a context of multiple seminaries. I've had the privilege of teaching current pastors and missionaries, Brazilian pastors and missionaries, and future pastors and missionaries. Some of the areas I taught were world religions, what they would call cultural anthropology, helping missionaries understand what's about to happen to them, new missionaries. Also, ecclesiology, that is the study of the church, about healthy churches and those kind of things, and then evangelism. And then, by God's grace, I wrote an ecclesiology textbook to help the Baptist brethren in my particular context to affirm and plant spiritually healthy churches. And then finally, I helped start a publishing house. Now, all this stuff is in Portuguese, but we wanted to have a way of spreading good Christian literature among our Baptist brethren. So that's a little bit about how our discipleship and how making disciples have transpired. And you guys have been a part of that by giving to your church and then also by giving to this offering in which you guys are taking up this month, right? And so now, let's take all this. Are you still with me? Let's take all this and let's bring it down to a personal challenge. A personal challenge in light of these two texts, the Great Commission in Matthew 28, and then also in Acts 1. So let me ask you this, just a few questions. And this would be more of a personal question for you. Are you a disciple of Christ? Are you a Christian? Now, I'm not saying, are you a Christian in name only, or are you a Christian in reality? You see, if you're a Christian in name only, I want to encourage you. Christ's invitation of forgiveness into becoming his disciple is open to all. Invest in your spiritual destiny
Invest in your spiritual destination. Invest in your spiritual health. I was read Matt yesterday something that Charles Haddon Spurgeon said. Charles Haddon Spurgeon was a Baptist pastor in the late 1800s, early 1900s, and no, late 18th century, early 19th century. And in fact, I named my son after this great Baptist preacher. He said the following: great numbers of persons have no concern for eternal things. They care more about their cats and dogs than about their eternal souls. How much more, probably, in the 21st century in our context? Let that not be said of you. Let that not be said of you. Now, if you are a Christian, in reality, and you are a member of this church, are you trying to do spiritually good to others? Well, let me just mention a few ways. Make it practical here of how you can do that. Be a covenant member in reality of this church. How? Serving, praying, celebrating and crying with your fellow members. That one member who's struggling, call them, encourage them. Pray and concern yourself with the eternal well-being of your family members, of your neighbors. And I know it's difficult these days, but your neighbors might be the only, you might be the only Christ that they will see as you live a Christian lifestyle and as you tell them about this living Christ. And then also collaborate with your church to help another church. If your church begins to help another church, then collaborate with that. And then also, give. 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 If you can't go to the nations, give to the nations. Now, Brother Matt said that you guys are this month, you have a goal and those kind of things. Let me just mention this. I want to give you this personal challenge. If each individual, each member gave $100, to that, you guys can practically double what the goal that you have. Is the nations worth it? Are the eternal souls of individuals worth it? Amen. I want to tell you what I tell people all the time. Think about that largest gift that you gave during Christmas time. Why don't you match that? Say, Debbie, you're talking a lot about money. Here in just a few years, most of us in this room are not going to be here. Does it really matter? Would it really matter, brother or sister? Let's pray for the nations and let's give to the nations. But my last challenge would be this. It might be in this room, among this church, there are some who would go and who need to go to the nations. I can't think of a better thing. If the Lord has put that into your heart, that you would respond and go. Now, if you do, then tell your pastor about it. Let this church walk with you and affirm you in that decision. And prepare as you are oriented. And then go. Go. As I mentioned, it's the hardest thing I've ever done. But it's the most blessed thing I have ever done. And if you're not, then as a church member, do all you can to hold the ropes by praying and giving to especially those who come out among you, as well as to others who have gone among our Southern Baptist churches. So, we say that we love God. Let me remind us all that we only love God because He first loved us. Christ, who lovingly died for His church, has commanded that we be His disciples and that we make disciples of others. Let's pray. Let's pray. And Brother Matt will come and he will conclude as he sees fit here. Lord, I thank You for the clarity of Your word. I thank You that You did not leave us in darkness, but that You have given us the light of Your word. And then also you gave us the testimony of brothers and sisters who shared with us the word. Lord, let us be faithful in our generation. Let this word that was read and explained today have its work in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you would just bow your heads and close your eyes for just a minute. Let's give ourselves an opportunity to respond to the gospel. You've heard the gospel spoken this morning. Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And your need for that. Your need for forgiveness. We come into this world sinful. And we will leave it that way unless we grab on to the one who gave his life for us. So I want to give you opportunity for that as you have been coming for weeks maybe or days, or maybe this is your first time. I want you to know a few things as we start this invitation. Number one, if you want to be saved, we believe the day is the day of salvation. If you won't harden your heart, if something inside of you is pulling on your heartstrings, that's not a preacher, that's not a story, that's not a missionary, that's the Holy Spirit of God. And you need to respond to the Holy Spirit. There's a room to my left, on the left of the stage, where we will counsel with you. There's counselors in there right now. If you need to be saved, if there's something inside of you saying, I need this Christ, I need this forgiveness, I encourage you right now to stand up and go to this room. Everybody's head's bowed and everybody's eyes are closed. We want you to know that you are a child of God. Number two is this. Maybe you've had that mission. You feel like maybe, hey, I'm supposed to be a missionary. I'm supposed to answer this call of God. What I'm going to ask is Brother David, if he'll also be available right now, if you come up and tell one of these counselors that you have that kind of calling, or you feel that kind of calling on your life, you believe God's calling you to that area, David would like to speak into your life, encourage you, help you, push you in that direction. And then third is this. If you'll commit yourself to the work of Christ on the earth, if you don't do it, who's going to do it? You are the instrument Christ has placed in this town and in this church for the glory of his kingdom here and everywhere else. So as I begin to pray, I'm going to ask lost people to get saved. People who feel the call of missions on their lives, I want y'all both to go to this room. And then thirdly, saved people who are going to embrace the call to be Christ's disciple. You're going to say, I'm going to do and be, I'm going to be that one that's going to bring the gospel and live it out here in Benton County in Camden, Tennessee. Saved people who are going to commit to that this morning, I want you to come to this altar, pile up those stones as we talk about the place where you meet with God. God meets with you, and you know that God's calling you to this place, this time, this hour, redeeming the days, for the days are evil. You were born for such a time as this. Father, in Jesus' name, now y'all come. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for those who will stand up right now in faith, God, believing that their heart is to be given to these things. Number one, the ones that want to be saved, the ones that want to be called to missions. And then the people who are in this room that are going to say, I'm going to disciple Benton County. I'm going to be a disciple of yours, Father. We thank you for the ones who, by faith now, are deciding in their heart, Lord, that these things are going to happen, Father. Father, push us, urge us, press us through the power of the Holy Spirit that we might know what your voice is saying to us this morning. We thank you for this time in Jesus' name. You come now. Anyone that would come and pray, anyone that would come and commit, there's people already here, you come. Don't waste your life living it for your wife, for your husband, for your family, for your job, for everything else in the world. Do not waste your life. Yesterday, as I was taking care of my children and other people's children, what kept coming to me through the Holy Spirit was, I want my family, I want my kids right now, I want my wife, that if they were asked something about their husband or their daddy, I want them to say, first thing that comes out of their mouth, he loves Jesus more than he loves anything on this earth. Not that he's a good preacher, that he's a good leader, or that
that he can catch fish or throw a ball or whatever you think or they think. You know how kids are. They think their parents are heroes. I don't want them to think any of that. I want them to say that my daddy was in love with Jesus, that he served Jesus, that he gave his life to Jesus, that he was faithful to Jesus, that he prayed to Jesus, that he looked to him, that everything was about Jesus. Anything less than that is not the goal. Can they see Jesus in your eyes, in your life, in your actions, in your habits? Can they see Jesus? Can they hear Jesus? People continuing to pray. Would you abandon all for Jesus? Would you give up the cushioned chairs today? Would you give up the big checks from our American jobs? Would you walk away from all of it if God called you to somewhere different, to do something different? At 18 years old, I got saved. At 19, I told Jesus, I'll do whatever you want me to do. That landed me here. But if in 10 years it lands me in a foreign country, praise be unto God who gives us this life, who gives us this breath. To hear well done is what we want to hear, church. To hear well done. Father, we thank you. We thank you for people who are given to you. God, not just by saying, I'm a Christian, but their life proves it. Their dedication proves it. Their love proves it. Their actions, their voices, everything that they have looks like Jesus. They're all in. They're disciples, they're fanatics, they're followers, they're not just fans. Thank you for David and his testimony this morning. The way he shared the gospel, the work that he's doing overseas. Thank you for his wife and his two children. Thank you, God, for a man and a woman who said yes to the Lord so many years ago and have faithfully served you, God. Now may we, as outsiders looking at what they're doing, God, may we, as those who are onlookers, not just be ones who gaze from a distance, but may we now get involved. May we now become missionaries. May we now give. May we see the glory of God. May we be obedient, Father. Thank you for that opportunity to hear from someone who's doing that and the challenge upon my life. Jesus, may we make you proud in this community and around the world. May your name be made famous by those who don't want to be. May we humble ourselves that you might be exalted. May we decrease so you must increase. May you be lifted high. May you receive the glory for all things. And may we praise you on the earth and live for you on the earth until we meet you in the place of glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give the Lord some praise this morning. Amen.
Hi, good morning, and welcome to Missionary Grow. We're so glad that you all chose to be here with us today. If this is your first time visiting with us, we hope that you've enjoyed today's worship and message and that you'll join us again soon. Also, first-time visitors, please take the time to go online to missionarygrove.com and fill out our MGBC connection card, and please be sure to stop by our Welcome Center, where we have a very special gift waiting for you. Ladies, our Daughters of the King Women's Ministry Group will be pursuing Christ together with a Lifeway simulcast that will be held here in GBC on May 27th, June 3rd, and June 10th at 6 p.m. We also have digital passes available for those of you who would like to attend remotely from home. For more information and details, please see Mrs. Tammy Smith. Attention, ladies! This year's Women of Joy Conference in Pigeon Forge will be October 8th through the 10th. The cost will be $100 to attend the conference, plus there will be accommodation expenses, which will be determined based on the number of women interested in attending. If you would be interested in attending Women of Joy, then please contact Mrs. Tammy Smith. Here at Missionary Grove, we have a prayer chain, and you can be included in our prayer chain through Facebook Messenger or through a text message thread. If you don't have a Facebook account and you would like to be included in our prayer chain through text messages, simply contact Mrs. Jackie Keniston and provide her with your contact information. If you and your families currently volunteer here at Missionary Grove, then we would like to invite you to please attend our Volunteer Appreciation Cookout. It will be held on Saturday, May 22nd at 4 p.m. out at the Eva Beach Pavilion. We do have a sign-up sheet posted at our Welcome Center, or you can sign up online through our church app or our website at missionarygrove.com. We are in need of a senior adult leader for our Happy Heart Senior Adult Group. If you're possibly interested, then please contact our volunteer coordinator, Mrs. Maddie Pierpoint. Throughout the month of May, MGBC will be collecting special funds for our missions in May. These funds will help support missions right here locally within our community and even missionaries throughout the world internationally. If you have a heart for missions or you have a heart to give, we would like to ask that you please take time to spend in prayer and see what God may lead you to give this month for missions in May. We will be hosting a vacation Bible school June 27th through the 30th from 5 p.m. until 7:30 p.m. We are in need of volunteers to help prepare food, teach, and much more. If you're interested in helping volunteer for Vacation Bible School, please contact Mrs. Alex Bailey. Thank you all again for being here with us at Missionary Grove today. We hope that you will join us again next week. Please remember to share hope through the love of Jesus. God bless.
Amen. I know you guys have had lots of announcements. I got just a few more for you. Don't forget about Sunday school, which is going to take place here in just a minute. So if you, making me nervous. If we got Sunday school taking place here in a few minutes, you got any questions about Sunday school, you want to know where to go or who to talk to about that, you can see me or Brother Matt or somebody will get you pointed in the right direction. Didn't Pastor David do a good job this morning? Amen. If y'all got any questions about missions or you got anything about missions that you want to talk to, Pastor David will be here to talk to you about that for the next little bit. And Brother Matt is going in the with missions in our mind. Brother Matt's going to be taking a missions trip to Honduras October the 23rd through the 30th. So if you would like to go on that, be sure and see Brother Matt. And then all right. Thank you. And then if Pursuit, if you would like to participate in the men's ministry Pursuit, that's going to be this Thursday. Our missions offering is currently at 43 out of 72 inches. That's where this tape is. So we are $7,100 and something dollars. So if the bottom of my feet is zero and the top of my head is $12,000, we are right here. You think I should wear this all day? I think I'll wear it through Sunday school anyway. Just a reminder. So if y'all like, when it gets to 72, we're not doing the tape thing. No, we're not. That'd be bad. All right, so don't forget about our offering. That's the new boxes on the back. If you would like to designate your offering to missions, please put it in the envelope and write on there as such. Let's pray. Everybody stand. Let's pray. We'll be dismissed. Father in heaven, we thank you for the many blessings that you've given us. God, we do love you. And God, we thank you for our missionaries. And God, we thank you for Pastor David, who's come this morning to teach us about the gospel and teach us about our responsibilities as disciples. God, I pray that we would be followers of Christ and that we would make more followers of Christ. God, we love you. We praise you. We honor you. I pray, God, this week you would help us to be a light in a dark place as we go into our community and show the world who you are and what you've done for us. This is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.